for number 10. The main TV inquisition's now over. Over half the Conservative membership have actually voted. So what's the state of the race? Sky News has teamed up with YouGov to find out. And here it is. On the basis of this, Liz Truss will be heading into Downing Street on September the 6th. She has a commanding lead. 66% say that they would vote for her. 34% say they would vote for Rishi Sunak. Now, that's actually a slight tightening on a couple of weeks ago, but nothing like on the scale that Rishi Sunak would need to overtake Liz Truss in this contest. Let's look at what's happening underneath the bonnet. And those people who have already voted, which is about 6 in 10... 31% say they voted for Rishi Sunak, 68% say they voted for Liz Truss. So even bigger lead there for Liz Truss. What about people that haven't? Does Rishi Sunak have a chance? Well, he, amongst people who haven't yet voted, 29% say that they voted for him, 44% say they voted for Liz Truss. But look at this, 26% say they don't know. That needs over half of these people to go to Rishi Sunak's corner in order for him to have any kind of chance. The numbers just are so difficult at this stage. But what are the challenges that whoever takes over will face? This poll gave us some clues. The affection that this party has, the Conservative Party, for Boris Johnson, evident in this. We asked, what if Boris Johnson was actually on the ballot paper and he wins by a landslide? 46% say they'd vote for him, 24% for Liz Truss, 23% for Rishi Sunak. This group of people, the Conservative Party, quite clear, they don't think Boris Johnson should have been slung out of number 10 at all in this poll. But what of the toxicity of this race? Lots of mudslinging, but has it rebounded on the membership? Well, the answer appears yes for a big minority. We asked whether Liz Truss should include Rishi Sunak in her cabinet. 52% say yes. But look at this, over a third of the Conservative Party say that the man that took the Conservative Party and the government and the country through the pandemic and wanted to be Prime Minister should be left out of the next Prime Minister's cabinet. That's quite a degree of dislike.
Conservative leader.
My mum studied hard and got the qualifications to become a pharmacist.
His mother's work as a pharmacist.
She met my dad, an NHS GP, and they settled in Southampton.
A message repeated over and over again by some of his supporters.
He's not of privileged background at all. Absolutely standard.
Well, we keep hearing that
background.
Actually, he went to Winchester School. That's pretty privileged.
He got a scholarship.
His mum was a chemist who ran a small shop in Southampton. His dad was a local doctor.
His mum was a pharmacist and his dad was a GP.
He was born into a pharmacy.
Rishi Sunak's campaign has told a powerful story of middle-class aspiration, how hard work and sacrifice has delivered great success. But his critics have a different narrative. They say his life and rapid ascent is in fact a tale of extraordinary privilege. One of his cabinet rivals told me the posh boys have seized control of the party again.
It was an attack Mr. Sunak had to endure publicly in the last television debate.
I saw kids at my school being let down in Leeds. I saw them not get the opportunities, not get the proper educational standards that you might have got at your school, Rishi.
Rishi Sunak was born in 1980 to Usha and Yashvir. His father was a GP, his mother a pharmacist, who later bought the pharmacy in Southampton. They wanted the best for their children, as they told a documentary team for the BBC in 2000, in footage rarely seen since.
You want your children to get educated, get degrees, be in good sort of reasonable professions.
And you can see the success of it.
Yeah.
I mean, you get an education, you got a good job, you have respect, you go up in your status.
After attending private schools in Southampton, in 1993, Mr. Sunak won a place at Winchester College, one of the poshest public schools in the country. Despite the claims of some of his supporters, he confirmed to us he did not receive a scholarship. His parents paid the fees, about £22,000 a year in today's money, as his father told the BBC.
I think financially it was quite a huge commitment for us because the fees at Winchester were double what we had to pay if we went to the local school in Southampton. So it was quite a large financial commitment.
The school's motto is manners maketh man, and Mr. Sunak adored it.
The setting of the school is just beautiful. And, you know, the quality of not just the teaching, but the facilities, the sport, the music, the drama, you know, the cricket pitches for me were just, you know, great places to play cricket on a Saturday. And it's something that I'll always remember very fondly. And in Ivenhoe University, a lot of my friends from school are there. At Winchester, I was one of very few Asians. I mean, the first generation into that level of society. It does put me in an elite, you know, of achievement, definitely in society. But I always consider myself sort of, you know, professional middle class.
It was a natural step to head straight to Oxford University, which at the time was accused of favouring private school students. It was an environment in which the young Rishi felt at home.
You know, I have friends who are aristocrats, I have friends who are upper class, I have friends who are, you know, working class, but I'm not working class, but I mix and match, and then I go to see kids from an inner city state school and tell them, you know, to apply to Oxford and talk to them about people like me, and then I shock them at the end of chatting to them for half an hour and tell them I was at Winchester and, you know, one of my best friends is from Eton or whatever, you know, and then they're like, oh, okay.
Sunak left Oxford for a coveted job at the American bank Goldman Sachs. And just months after graduating, he snapped up a one-bedroom flat here in the Royal Borough of Kensington and Chelsea for £210,000, with a little help we've discovered from the bank of mum and dad.
Documents held at the land registry show he was able to do that with an interest-free loan from his parents of £105,000 in return for a share of any profit. The loan was worth more than the average house price in Britain at the time. He was just 21 years old. The flat, which he still owns, is now worth an estimated £750,000. But Mr. Sunak had his sights set on America. After getting a scholarship to do an MBA at Stanford University, he moved to the upscale Los Angeles suburb of Santa Monica in California with his new wife, Akshata Murthy, the daughter of one of India's richest entrepreneurs. Public records show the couple moved into an apartment in this stunning beachfront property. We can't film inside, but a marketing video for the property boasts of an internal elevator to whisk you up to the master bedroom. The rent was just under $20,000 a month, around £13,000 at the time.
The mild weather, the palm trees, the ocean views are all desirable. And Hollywood makes it even more desirable. Everyone knows about Southern California. The average Joe would not be able to afford to live close to the beach or on the beach.
It was conveniently close to the office where Mr. Sunak set up a US branch of the hedge fund Thelem Partners in 2010. He was named as a partner at the time. The branch was ultimately owned by a company registered in the Cayman Islands, a tax haven. We've obtained this document from the US authorities. It lists three investment funds managed by Mr. Sunak's branch. We've identified that funds with those names were also based in tax havens, including two in the Cayman Islands. And there's one more detail. The document shows how partners in the hedge fund were paid with a share of the tax haven funds they managed.
Did Mr. Sunak earn bonuses offshore in the Cayman Islands? If so, what happened to them? We've asked him for an answer.
Mr. Sunak did not deny that he received assets in tax havens, but he told us any assets he had were subject to US tax, which was paid in full. There's no suggestion Mr. Sunak did anything illegal. In June 2014, the couple made a commitment to this penthouse, just a stone's throw from the beach. The price, some $6.8 million. We can't find a mortgage. Apparently, it was bought for cash.
Double trouble for Rishi Sunak and his wife. He admits he had residency status in the US even as he was appointed Chancellor. And tonight his wife says she will pay UK taxes on the millions she earns around the world.
The Sunak family's personal wealth came to public attention in the spring when it emerged his wife was a non-dom, meaning she didn't pay UK tax on her foreign income. It also transpired he'd held a green card, permitting him residency in the US until just last year. As the only member of the cabinet to make the Sunday Times rich list, Mr. Sunak's wealth has become his Achilles heel, as he struggles to prove he understands the plight of ordinary people wrestling with the worst cost of living crisis in a century.
There have been big questions about your judgment when it came to your green card status and your wife's non-dom status.
So I've always been a completely normal UK taxpayer. My wife is from another country, so she's treated differently. But she explained that in the spring and she resolved that issue. But look, there is commentary about my wife's family's wealth. And so let me just address that head on because I think it's worth doing, because I'm actually incredibly proud of what my parents-in-law built. My father-in-law came from absolutely nothing and just had a dream and a couple of £100 that my mother-in-law's savings provided him. And with that, he went on to build one of the world's largest, most respected, most successful companies.
He married a very, very wealthy woman. Is that a problem? Is that tax status a problem?
No, it's not a problem. I'll tell you why. Because we believe in aspiration in the Conservative Party. We believe that if you're born in a chemist shop in Southampton and you go on to get a great education on merit, to have a great business career on merit, to fall in love with whoever you want to fall in love with, and then to have a political career in which you really deliver for the country in some of the most difficult times, I call that a success. And in the Conservative Party, we're in favour of people making a success of their lives.
My values are non-negotiable. Patriotism, fairness, hard work.
But even if he wins over the Conservative membership to clinch the leadership and become Prime Minister, winning over the British public amid unprecedented economic turmoil may be a far tougher challenge.
Some routine. The cabinet gathering for its weekly meeting.
Good morning.
But the real action right now is outside Downing Street, as politicians focus on who to put back inside Number 10.
Uniting around one leader.
There are plenty of excellent candidates.
Secretary of State, who are you going to back?
I haven't made my decision yet.
One decision was made today, which contenders were through to the second round. Three withdrawing without the numbers, but eight still in the race.
Those eight will go to the first round ballot tomorrow between 1:30 and 3:30, with the results announced as soon as we can. Please welcome Rishi Sunak.
Ready for that ballot with a big cabinet beast backing him, the former Chancellor Rishi Sunak. Leading in this race, but keen as well not to put too much distance between himself and his former boss.
I want to talk about Boris Johnson. I will have no part in a rewriting of history that seeks to demonise Boris.
Wanting to align with his foe while also setting himself apart from other contenders when it comes to tax policy.
We need a return to traditional Conservative economic values, and that means honesty and responsibility, not fairy tales. It is not credible to promise lots more spending and lower taxes.
But it is credible to question this candidate over wider issues.
You've just stood here and said Boris Johnson's a remarkable person. You don't want history to demonise him. The party's just ousted him on the basis of conduct, probity and causing division. And here you are. You have a police fine over Partygate. And there have been questions, too, over your very wealthy family avoiding paying millions of pounds in tax. So I put it to you that you're not a clean start, that you might be more of the same.
I think it's important that we do, whoever wins this election, does restore trust, because trust has been broken and we need to rebuild all of that with the country. What has really humbled me and given me an enormous amount of encouragement is the breadth of support from people, it's from all wings of the party, it's from all regions of the party, and that's why I believe I'm best placed to bring the party back together.
But just as Mr Sunak was launching his bid, support from the Johnson wing of the party coalescing behind Foreign Secretary Liz Truss.
The candidate that we select, and for me it's Liz who I'm going to back, will continue with those manifesto promises and will continue to deliver for the government and for the Conservative Party.
But you don't like Rishi Sunak, do you?
This a man keen to stop Rishi Sunak in his tracks.
I think Mr Sunak is an extremely personable man, but I think he was not running the economy well. And I've made this clear.
And you think he betrayed your Prime Minister, the person that you have consistently supported, Boris Johnson?
I think it's very interesting that somebody should start a campaign, according to reports, in December of last year.
away from the big beasts in the fight, this backbencher keen to break from the past.
We need a clean start. For me, that is much more than just a slogan or a catchphrase. It summarises our advance orders for the next decade. It allows us to move forward together, afresh, optimistic, enthusiastic, confident, post-Brexit, and ready to seize the moment.
As is this ex-minister on the right of the party and through to the next round.
We have overburdened our economy. There is too much unproductive public spending, consuming taxpayers' hard-earned money, and there are too many well-meaning regulations slowing growth and clogging up the arteries of the economy.
A moment of
calm. Did you go to him and say, the parties have got to stop, you've got to get rid of these sexual abusers?
Of course, I've had disagreements with the Prime Minister in private over the course of my time in office.
Is Boris Johnson honest?
Sometimes.
Even when you said you might like to be leader one day, you didn't call for him to go.
I think I made it very clear, very early.
Well, you hinted.
No, I don't think I hinted.
When did you stand up for integrity and honesty? When did you tell Boris Johnson he was wrong and he had to go?
I'm a loyal person. I stood by Boris Johnson.
Do you support, do you trust all the other candidates to be Prime Minister?
We're here to win an
election. Well, you're not saying you do trust them. We all know that.
Why should the public trust any of you?
I have been somebody in government who has said I will deliver things, often things that people said were impossible. For example, the trade deals after we left the EU, people said it would be difficult to get as good a deal as we did. I secured deals with Japan, with Australia. I delivered what I said I would deliver.
When did you stand up for integrity and honesty? When did you tell Boris Johnson he was wrong and he had to go?
I'm a loyal person. I stood by Boris Johnson. Of course, I raised issues with him in private.
Tom Tugendhat, why should they trust you?
Trust in politics has been collapsing. Trust in our party has been collapsing, let's be frank. We all know that we need a clean start, and many people are asking the right questions on this. But I swore loyalty to our country, and that's where I will always owe my loyalty.
Rishi Sunak, why should they trust you when you were the second most powerful person in the country? When did you ever stand up to him about the COVID parties or Chris Pincher being Deputy Chief Whip?
Prasanth, I always tried to give the Prime Minister the benefit of the doubt, and that became increasingly hard. I got to a point recently where enough was enough.
Did you go to him and say, the parties have got to stop, you've got to get rid of these sexual abusers?
Of course, I've had disagreements with the Prime Minister in private over the course of my time in office. But what I would say is, I'm not going to walk away from everything that the Prime Minister and this government has done over the past few years.
Kemi Badenoch, you are probably the least well-known of the candidates. Wouldn't the thing that would restore trust were you to win be for you to call a general election and say, trust me? Because they don't know who you are.
That is not the way that I would go. No one would know who I was, you say, but then I wouldn't have any time to show who I was.
Why you can trust me is because I have spoken truth to power. I had the opportunity to serve at a higher office in this government, and my answer to the Prime Minister was longer than the traditional one.
One question, yes or no, is Boris Johnson honest?
Sometimes.
Is Boris Johnson honest?
He is somebody who has
just yes or no will do.
No, I'm not doing a yes or no because I think it would be wrong to do that.
There were a number of reasons that I resigned, but trust and honesty was part of that.
Liz Truss, is he honest?
He has been very clear himself that he made mistakes in government.
Is Boris Johnson an honest man?
What will you do to make a clean break with Boris Johnson?
Penny Mordaunt.
Well, I think we all stood together on a manifesto that we've yet to deliver. And I think that actually part of restoring trust is to deliver on that manifesto.
I would appoint people because they were talented, not because they were loyal. I would trust even the people who did not support me to work with me because we're all on the same team.
The first thing I'm going to do is run. That's why I'm here, because we need a break. We need a break from the government of the past. We need a break from those who sat around the table.
The first is to be honest.